Lee arrived at the McLean house first, magnificent in a crisp gray uniform, an engraved sword at his side. "I have probably to be General Grant's prisoner," he explained to an aide, "and thought I must make my best appearance." He waited half an hour for Grant to arrive. The Union commander wore a private's dirty jacket. His boots and trousers were splattered with mud. He had no sword. The two commanders shook hands.
What General Lee's feelings were, I do not know. As he was a man of much dignity, with an impassible face, his feelings were entirely concealed from my observation. But my own feelings were sad and depressed. I felt like anything rather than rejoicing at the downfall of a foe who had fought so long and valiantly and had suffered so much for a cause, though that cause was, I believe, one of the worst for which people ever fought.
Grant reminded Lee that they had met once before during the Mexican War. Lee said he had not remembered what Grant looked like.
Our conversation grew so pleasant that I almost forgot the object of the meeting. General Lee called my attention to the object.
They knew each other. Grant remembered Lee very well. Lee didn't quite remember Grant. That was understandable from the time that they were acquainted back in the early days. But I think it was the sensitivity that the two men had for each other and for the moment. Enormous dignity and yet the necessary informality. Grant not wanting to get to the point too quickly. Lee bringing him up shortly to the point of why they're together. Lee dressed in his last good uniform. Grant apologizing that he was rushing from the field and didn't have time to change. The scribe being unable to hold the pen steady and having it taken by another soldier. That from Lee's point of view, awful moment, and from Grant's point of view, glorious moment, and yet for the two of them, a sad and quiet moment. And Lee taking his leave and doffing his hat from traveler and riding back to his troops after securing those reasonable terms. It was the beginning of the unification of the country.
The terms Grant offered were simple and generous. Confederate officers could keep their sidearms and personal possessions. Officers and men who owned their own horses could keep them too. It was planting season. Grant asked Lee how many men he had and if they needed any rations. Lee said he no longer knew the size of his army, but he was sure all his men were hungry. Grant offered 25,000 rations.
"This will have the best effect upon my men. It will be very gratifying and do much toward conciliating our people."
Colonel Eli S. Parker, a Seneca Indian and a member of Grant's staff, inscribed the articles of surrender for the two commanders to sign. The two men shook hands again. Lee left the house, mounted Traveler, and started back toward his army. The Union soldiers began to cheer. Grant ordered them to stop. "The Confederates are now our prisoners," he explained, "and we do not want to exult over their downfall. The war is over. The rebels are our countrymen again.